mother, Dr. Barbara Chaffee. She worked for decades helping HIV/AIDS patients around the Southern Tier. Dr. Chaffee died a bit over a year ago, and now her son Tim Chaffee, who is very talented as a filmmaker and director, is working on a documentary. We'll hear about his new project, and we'll also hear how people who may have known his mom, Barbara Chaffee, can help assist to make that project a reality. It's 1017 WNBF. It's 1032, News Radio 1290 WNBF. Coming up, we'll talk with Tim Chaffee, a Binghamton native and filmmaker. He has a special project that he'd like to share with us, and that's next. 1290 WNBF.
No, I would not give you false hope on this strange and mournful day. But the mother and child reunion is only a motion away. Oh, little daughter of mine, I care for the life of me. Remember a Saturday. No, they say let it be. It just don't work out that way. In the course of a lifetime runs over and over again.
News Radio 1290 WNBF with Binghamton Now on a Wednesday morning, and we welcome to the studio Tim Chaffee, a Binghamton native and filmmaker. Welcome.
Hi, thank you. Thanks for having me, Bob.
You can take this off your bucket list. Your first ever radio interview.
That's right. That's right.
Well, it's fun. It's painless, and I know your friends will be envious, saying, "Wow, you were in a radio studio. Tell me, how nice was it?"
It's beautiful. It's beautiful.
It's remarkable.
I really like the waterfall you have set up over there, and the
and you got here early enough to enjoy our green room with the exquisite selection of beverages and rare taste treats. So.
Yes, yes, yes.
We got that idea from the Today Show. We found out what NBC's Today Show does, and now we have done them one better. They're envious of our green room.
It is so very impressive.
It's one, you know, it's always one upmanship in the broadcast business. Anyway, I am so glad we have this chance to get together and tell people here in the Binghamton area and beyond about a project that you recently have embarked on, and many people here in Broome County will recall the work that your mom did, Dr. Barbara Chaffee, over many years, helping a lot of people who were in real need of assistance at a time when not a great deal of help was available. Tell us a little bit about the story of your mom.
Sure. Well, the story, sort of where I pick up with it, is that about a year and a half ago, she passed away after a long battle with breast cancer. And at that time, you know, I had grown up living with her. Obviously, she raised me, but I didn't know a whole lot about the work she had really done. I knew she worked with AIDS and HIV patients, but that was about it. And then at her funeral, person after person kept coming up to me and saying, "Your mom saved my life. I wouldn't be here if it weren't for your mom." And that really inspired me to go after that story and find out more about this woman who, you know, there was so much I didn't get a chance to learn about her. And now I am, by going out and meeting some of those patients, meeting some of her colleagues. And as soon as I started investigating the story, it really was an amazing story. I mean, a lot of people know the basics of the AIDS story, that, you know, the epidemic hit New York, San Francisco, thousands were getting sick and dying. Up here, the story really picks up when some of those guys, young men who had moved out of this area down to New York to make something of themselves, came home because they couldn't get care down in New York. You know, the hospitals were overwhelmed, and they came back home, unfortunately, to die. To be taken back in by their families, And that's sort of where the story of AIDS in Binghamton picks up. And unfortunately, it was a dark and scary time. There was a lot of fear. There was a lot of stigma. And those patients didn't always get the best care. There were doctors who refused to treat them. There were, you know, postal workers who refused to deliver the mail to their house.
Well, there were reporters who were afraid to interview them.
Yes, exactly. But there were, you know, some... there was a community of brave people, of concerned people, who came together and started taking care of those patients and those people. And my mom was one of them. And in the late 80s, she started a AIDS and HIV clinic at the health department. And then shortly thereafter, moved that practice over to UHS, over at Binghamton General and Binghamton Family Care, which is what it was called at the time. And for 20 years, she took care of those patients and really was the AIDS and HIV expert in the area. And she not only did she take care of those patients and give them the care they so badly needed, but she also, you know, lobbied for them in Albany. She represented the area at the New York AIDS Institute on various panels and things. So really from the very personal interaction all the way up to the state and national level, she was an advocate and you know, a caregiver.
And she also served to educate people in this area. She did frequent interviews on radio and TV and with the newspaper because, you know, in this area, being relatively small and with a lot of people who just took a while to understand what HIV was, it was not something that was instantly understood and that people had a full appreciation of what it is, how it might be treated, and also how to appropriately interact with people who had been diagnosed. Your mother helped serve as sort of the key person who was kind of a public face to help put some things in context and perspective for the people in the Southern Tier.
Yeah, you know, so much of the battle with AIDS, I think, had to do with education. Just, you know, teaching people that there was nothing to be afraid of, or, you know, that you couldn't catch AIDS from being in the same room with someone with HIV. And education was such a key component of that. You know, as you said, my mom did many educational things. She did public outreach. She went on news programs, including this one, I believe, at some point.
She definitely was not on this particular program, but she was on this station with some frequency.
Yeah.
And as she, you know, she was always available for public affairs programs and for news updates. Sometimes new information would come out in the national media, and she served as a person, a contact person, who would help to explain it in a way that people who were not medical experts could understand and appreciate.
Yeah. And I should say she was not alone in this work. It really is a whole community that came together around this issue in Binghamton. The work of the people at the Southern Tier AIDS Program, which just celebrated 30 years of existence. And celebrate is, you know, obviously a mixed word, but it is wonderful that they have been here working with my mom and working with the community to teach people, to educate. You know, it's amazing to me that in a very short span, it went from a disease that, you know, people were scared of, that there was so much fear about, to by the time I was, you know, in middle school or high school, everybody went out for the AIDS walk. You know, this community, you know, the AIDS walk that they run each year, and now the ride for life that they do, you know, that's sort of unimaginable that the community could rally like that 30 years ago. It was
so there was a transformation. There was an evolution as more information came out. It should also be noted too that with efforts by Dr. Chaffee and others with the Broome County Health Department and the Southern Tier AIDS Program, not only were HIV AIDS patients treated appropriately and given respect, but because of the educational efforts, one has to be certain that lives were saved because people got information they needed to protect themselves, protect their loved ones, and that might not have been the information that was easily accessible otherwise. This happened so much before people were able to easily access health information online.
Yeah, it's true. And one of the things my mom pushed for, you talk about information, one of the key pieces of information with this was your status, if you were infected or not. And one of the things my mom pushed for was getting confidential and anonymous testing available here in Binghamton. In the late 80s, early 90s, you had to drive to Syracuse to do it. You know, you had to go to Albany or down to the city. And she pushed to make it available here in the health department. They did it at a number of bars and locations around the area that made it accessible and put it in places, you know, somebody might be afraid to take the drive over to the health department, but you know, if they happened to be at the bar that day and there were counselors there doing testing, then maybe they were willing to do that. And once you know your status, that's the first step in, you know, in preventing the disease and preventing the spread of the disease, in taking the steps to make sure that you have a long and healthy life.
Our guest is Binghamton native and filmmaker Tim Chaffee. You have, I think, a great project that's underway, and that's the reason for your appearance here today, to let people know about what you're working on and also how they can support this going forward. Tell us about the documentary that you're planning to make to honor the life and work of your mother.
Sure. So the website, I'll get it in while I'm thinking of it, is wildgeesefilms.net. Please go there for more information if you'd like to support or help the project in any way. That's the place to do it. Follow us on Facebook, Twitter, all that stuff. The film, I think, is really important. I think, you know, I'm excited to tell a story, what is ultimately a hopeful and uplifting story about this area. I love this area. I'm a native son. I also think this documentary will be important in the world of AIDS documentaries. When you think of the movies that have been out there, you think of How to Survive a Plague, or which was nominated for an Oscar a few years ago. And the stories that most people know are about New York and San Francisco, Africa, the, you know, major epidemic centers, the major centers of the epidemic. And I think it's important to tell the story of a smaller community and how this epidemic, you know, affected a community like ours, and how we really came together to combat it and support.
So how far along are you? Are you just in the early planning stages, or where do you stand?
I'm actually pretty far along. We're wrapping up our what's called primary photography, doing our main interviews and shooting up here. We've been doing that this summer. And then the next couple of months are going to be, you know, raising awareness, obviously continuing to fundraise, but also doing the editing, all of the post-production documentaries. People don't realize documentaries really come together after the shooting is done. That's where you make the story. And so there's all of that. And then hopefully we're going to get it out to some big film festivals, maybe get it to TV or what have you. And what I'm really excited about is, in today's day and age, with the way you can stream movies over the various distribution outlets out there, I think this story, you know, this could end up being broadcast right into the home of somebody living in another small community somewhere else in the country who feels like they're alone, and it'll let them know that there are people out there who will support them and who are going through the same things that they are.
So do you have a target date for completion? I would have to ask.
Of course. I'm hoping that it'll be, you know, submitting to festivals by the end of the year. So in the next couple of months, it'll really come together. And then by late fall, hopefully we're sending it off to, who knows, Sundance or something.
Well, I wish you the best. Just over the last day or so, I've seen some just very short samples of the work you do. It's some very impressive stuff. It's remarkable what can be done by people who have the talent and the proper equipment and the right amount of time to do documentaries and to shoot things intelligently and basically do it in an artistic style. It's very, very interesting. As you mentioned, there is a website if people want more information, if they want to get involved or possibly donate for this project. They're welcome to do that. And you can give the web address again.
Sure. That's wildgeesefilms.net. And we are on Facebook and Twitter and all of that as well.
And YouTube.
And YouTube.
Google
Plus. And as you say, it takes a lot of hard work, talent, equipment, all of those things, and none of that comes for cheap.
No.
So it's a local story and one I care passionately about, and that's why I'm reaching out to the local community to please help support this project. I know there's a lot of people out there who've been touched by this, and I'm hoping to tell everyone's story in some small way, and every little bit of support you can give helps a great deal.
It's a loving tribute by a son who clearly has come to appreciate all the work that his mom did in her professional life, how she touched so many people here in the Binghamton area. Tim Chaffee, I'll invite you back on the program at some point with a progress report, perhaps at the point when the project is complete and you're able to unveil it publicly. I think our listeners will be very very interested in an update. In fact, along the way, you can keep us posted, too, with progress reports.
We'll do.
Tim Chaffee, a Binghamton native and documentary maker, with us on our Tuesday program. Why say Tuesday? Is it Tuesday? It's Wednesday. Time flies when you're having fun. Thanks so much, Tim.
All right. Thank you.
You're listening to Binghamton Now with Bob Joseph on News Radio 1290, WNBF.